Hello and welcome to Indianomics. Exactly a year ago, on the 12th of February, midnight, 2018, the Reserve Bank issued one of its strictest circulars ever on recognizing bad loans and restructuring them before it is too late. The circular also forced corporates, borrowers that is, to pay dues on due date and not 80 days after due, just to make money at the bank's expense and yet escape the NPA tag. Most bankers and borrowers agree that the circular was in the nature of a new constitution for corporate India and for the banking sector. Has it changed life? If yes, how? To discuss that, we have with us a bunch of veteran bankers, R.K. Bansal, former ED, IDBI, Sunil Srivastava, former Deputy Managing Director, State Bank, B.P. Sharma, former ED, Bank of Baroda, and bankruptcy lawyer Suharsh Sinha of AZB and Partners. Gentlemen, welcome. But before we start with our panel, let me ask my co-anchor Ritu Singh to outline the key features of that seminal circular of 1 year ago, the February 12th circular. Ritu.
Well, the big change really is that banks do not now wait until the 90th day of default when the account turns an NPA to start taking steps towards resolution plans. What the circular states very simply is that within the first day of delay in repayment, that is, even when it's in SMA zero category, banks have to then put together a resolution plan for which they've been given a timeline of 180 days within which the resolution plan will have to be firmed up. If they're able to approve the resolution plan, then yes, that is a green mark. But if they fail to move the resolution plan within 180 days, banks will then be forced to send the company or the borrower into the bankruptcy and insolvency court within 15 days of that 180-day deadline ending. Now, does the approval of the resolution plan in 180 days really mean that the account can be reverted from a non-performing to a standard? Well, that's not the case. The Reserve Bank of India in its Feb 12 circular has specified a time period which is from the end of that 180-day time period when the resolution has been implemented up until the time that 20% of the outstanding principal debt is repaid as the time which is specified period, and during that time no default can happen, and only after that can the account be reverted back to NPA. If there is a default even in that specified period, banks would again be required to take that company to the NCLT within 15 days.
Okay, and the other important announcement in that circular was that banks had to send all stressed accounts of over 2,000 crore within 6 months to the NCLT. They must try to resolve them within 6 months. And if not, all the existing loans, stressed loans over 2,000 crore, had to be taken to the NCLT, the bankruptcy court. Of course, no resolution happened. In fact, the stressed power companies and some shipping companies actually took the Reserve Bank to court. And at the moment, the apex court, the Supreme Court, is going to decide on February 19 whether that law is kosher or whether it can be amended or needs to be amended. The hearing could take much longer than just February 19. So at the moment, the circular, in a sense, is not applicable to power companies, shipping companies and one sugar company. But be that as it may, it is still the law of the land, and therefore, how does it work? Let me start with my guests. Well, first up, let me ask you, Mr. Bansal, do you think that it has changed the behavior of even good borrowers? You can't pay 1 month after due date, 2 months after due date, and make make interest on your mutual funds or liquid funds and then pay the banks. You have to pay on due date. Mr. Bansal, you can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, but slightly break up in the voice. But what I understand is change in behavior is certainly there. And that's a combination of FAB 12 circular plus NCLT. So the overall fear of going to NCLT by any borrower, I think that is playing its role. And people are making their best efforts to keep the accounts either standard or they go to the banks to at least find a resolution or settle the account. I think the change in behavior is certainly there. As far as the circular otherwise is concerned, because it was applying to about 2,000 crore cases. So I think banks are seriously looking at some resolution. So there are different ways. So, and those cases are known in the market now. I think almost everyone knows which are those cases.
Okay.
I think everywhere banks are working on that.
Okay. Now, I just wanted to know if behavior of good borrowers has changed. Sunil, can I come to you on that? Do you think banks are at least getting their dues quickly?
Yeah, let me respond to you by saying that, you know, on a principle-based, this February 12th circular could not have been more opportune. In fact, it sets the ground rules, and perhaps it should have been introduced maybe 10 years earlier.
Okay.
But on the practical part of it, when you look at the practical part of it, definitely it has made the borrowers very, very circumspect in taking further risks. And this has caused a behavioral change, in as much as they would not like to cross that Lakshman Rekha of 90 days or within that 180 days. And that is leading to some of these borrowers sort of not clinging on to their equity, which they had done in the past.
Okay.
So that is an opportunity which is there opening up in the Indian market.
Okay. Mr. Sharma, you're also with us. The same question to you. In the last 1 year, since the circular was introduced, is there a visible change in the behavior of borrowers?
See, it is visible only in case of fence-sitters. That means the borrower who had money to repay but were delaying, dying, there it has acted, it has helped. But where the project has failed or it is incurring loss, I don't think this guideline per se has helped.
Okay. Okay. Mr. Sharma, what about bankers becoming aware that this borrower has defaulted with someone else because the new rule, that is the Feb 12 circular, required that every bank must tell RBI or the CRILC within a week if somebody has not paid on due date.
See, this information was also available to bank through CIBIL. Now it is quicker and probably on a real-time basis it has helped. But I will tell you, this RBI guidelines has helped in one thing.
Yes.
And that is very important. The tendency of borrower to take an additional dose of credit to service the existing debt, that has stopped.
Okay.
That is a very important effect these guidelines have on these borrowers.
Okay.
The backers who were also sometimes tempted to avoid classification as NPA and thereby required to make provision, and the borrowers were smart enough. So these guidelines has put a stop to that.
Okay.
To that extent, I welcome these guidelines.
Okay. You know, let me get to Sunil on this. Sunil, when we did our research for this particular panel discussion, a lot of bankers said that resolution is not very easy in India, especially now that the joint lender forum has ceased to exist. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I'll just respond to Mr. Sharma first before taking on to your question.
Sure.
You see, if you go down the totem pole, I told you on principle, this is a very good circular. But in actuality, what happens is that lower down the totem pole, the default happens as you go down the lower totem pole because the payments are always stuck as you go down the pole. So while the higher grade borrowers who are delaying the payments to the next grade and so on and so forth, they are able to, on their own merit, raise further funds or they have sufficient liquidity. It's the guys below, the MSMEs, etc., who suffer. So, you know, it's not a question of all borrowers. If you look at the larger borrowers, they are able to, most of them are delivered and they have sufficient cash. But the guys down the low totem pole and the last guy is becoming an NPA.
Actually, I take your point completely.
Now, on your question.
Yes, go ahead.
This was, can you repeat that question, please?
No, my point is that because one banker reports to CRILC, the others are alerted. That's what Mr. Sharma said. That is, you know, you quickly get information that somebody else is borrowing from another bank to pay you, perhaps, or just increasing his liability and you don't know about it.
So in larger cases, we have seen, you know, in where there's multiple banker consortium, the smallest bank, the bank with the smallest exposure, keeps holding on. Because they are not interested in restructuring, they hope that the borrower will borrow from elsewhere and pay him off. And therefore, these resolution plans get stuck and eventually get into an NCLT situation. Now, that requires 100% compliance by all lenders.
Yes.
As against the 66% for the NCLT. You know, that's a weakness of the system.
Mr. Bansal, you know, you've also been on the committee of creditors for several cases. You know, since the circular was introduced, do you think getting 100% approval from the lenders, that has been one of the biggest challenges?
Getting consent from the lenders?
Yes, complete consent.
For a restructuring.
The restructuring as such with this circular actually has become very difficult in any case, because the conditions stipulated by RBI of 20% payment and rating from the two rating agencies, I mean, those are virtually like it should be good credit. Now, if it has been so good credit, then it should not have been in this default situation. So most likely this restructuring, my feeling is restructuring will not happen except, I mean, in a very rare cases, one or two cases. What will happen is clients will maybe try to find some refinancing. I think that is the most likely situation, I feel, rather than restructuring in the traditional sense. That will not happen because it's not a question of banks agreeing or not agreeing. I think the conditions stipulated for restructuring are quite tough, I think. So quite stiff.
Okay. Let me invite Suharsh now into the conversation as maybe the neutral party, the outside party, but who has a ledger of practically every bad loan. What is your sense? One banker told me this is like, you know, wanting a machine gun to swat a fly. In all cases, the IBC cannot be a solution. We should have intermediate solutions, but there aren't, because the JLF is, you know, dysfunctional with this circular. As well, the circular requires 100% approval of all the bankers, and that's usually not forthcoming. So do you think that part is becoming a logjam?
Thank you. So, I mean, if you ask the RBI is very clear that nowhere in the circular does it say that you need 100% consent. But at the same time, it doesn't, it's silent on it. Exactly. So I think the practical view being taken in the market, and if you're an investor, the view you will take is that you actually require 100% consent. And that is actually turning out to be a bit of a hurdle. Because if you look at any of the other thresholds which are prescribed under various laws, be it a scheme of arrangement under Companies Act, the threshold there is 75%. In IBC, it's 66%. Under the JLF, it used to be 66%. So this getting 100% buy-in is actually going to be a real issue. To some extent, the intercreditor agreement under SASHAKT, that could come to the rescue in certain situations. But, you know, we need to remember that the people who have signed on to SASHAKT are only the public sector banks and a select few private banks. If you happen to be a foreign bondholder, like what happened in the case of Arcom, a bunch of Chinese bondholders also filed IBC against Arcom, other than Ericsson. In those situations, you cannot cram down the bondholders. And even the lenders who have signed SASHAKT, I mean, it happened after a lot of persistent persuasion by finance ministry. So I think that's that is an area of concern under the FEB12 circular. But I think if you look at the FEB12 circular and its impact, it would be unfair to see only the legacy cases, because the legacy cases, obviously, many of them are beyond redemption and they deserve to go to NCA and probably even get liquidated. And this is not going to help them. But going forward, I think it's going to change lender behavior and borrower behavior. I'm sure lenders now, and I'm sure the senior bankers on the show may concur, is the lenders now will monitor the accounts of even their AAA rated companies a lot more carefully to make sure they don't reach a stage where you have no option but to refer them into the FEB12 circular. So I think it's not only a retrospective vision on FEB12, but going forward, I think it's going to have a huge impact on credit culture and how robust balance sheet of companies are going to be.
Could you also quickly bring us up to speed with what has happened in the Supreme Court with respect to this case so
what
far?
Is the status, legal status of the circular?
Sure. So if you recall that IBC, the constitutionality of IBC as well as constitutionality of the RBI circular, both happened at the same time, both went to Supreme Court at the same time. So Supreme Court decided that, you know, it's more important to decide the IBC matter first, which is the judgment we saw a few weeks back. And the next hearing in the FEB12 judgment is on the 19th of Feb. And I think the arguments will start, and it may take, it's difficult to say really, but it could take up to a month or so before we have a final judgment on that question.
Okay. Let me take from what Suharsh said and Sunil Srivastava said, that, you know, many people down the line are not paying, and that is why it's very difficult to resolve cases. The government is the biggest buyer of goods and services, and often government payments are delayed. So what is the point of this circular if government doesn't change its behavior? That question to my bankers and my guests. So let me come to you, Sunil, since you raised that issue. Can the Reserve Bank alone discipline banks and expect the rest of the system to fall in line? Or should it have worked together, probably introduce the treads as compulsory listing on the treads, so that if you don't pay, you know, you're a defaulter on the exchange. You know, some such ecosystem changes were needed before this circular was passed.
You touched my favorite topic, actually, Lata.
Okay.
So the fact of the matter is that you need to have certainty and also predictability in your cash flows to be expecting the entire value chain to adhere to a certain rule. Now, when there is no predictability, there is no certainty. And if you look at, you know, if you just a case in point is the EPC sector. Mm. How many companies in the EPC sector have gone for liquidation or have gone to the NCLT? Mm. And today is very difficult for any EPC company to get additional financing for even bank guarantees. Mm. Why? Because somewhere down the line, their payments have got stuck because they are in various stages of arbitration or appeal or the courts. Now, if those cash flows are stuck, I can imagine, you know, a larger company, which is a AAA rated company, to raise money because of its rating. But down the value chain, these guys will have quite a problem correcting the situation.
Yeah, but Mr. Sharma, because you have, the Reserve Bank can't change the world. But if it tells banks that you have to live by these rules, now in subsequent cases, is it not possible for a vendor to put it into his SLA, into his, you know, service agreement and say that, you know, government, if you don't pay me within this time, you will have to pay an interest of 18% because that's what the bank is asking from me. In that sense, is it making it easier for even the small guy in coming cases, in prospective cases?
Well, an infant cannot fight with a big brother.
Okay.
See, that is not possible. But what I would like to emphasize that the regulatory guidelines, so far it relates to MSME, or I'll take out the word M, this M is a misnomer. Mm. Small and micro, I don't think those stringent guidelines are applicable.
Yes.
And there are leeways available to the banks to come to their rescue. Mm. So it's not that the same set of guidelines, ipso facto applicable to small and micro.
Okay.
And there is a need to have a separate set of guidelines for this sector. This sector needs all the...
No, but that is given, no? This is only applicable to loans over 50 crores. So that is anyway taken care. Does it actually strengthen the hand of even a larger company, say a 500 crore company, when it is negotiating with a 5,000 crore company, saying that if you delay, then, you know, my banker will catch hold of me and therefore I'm putting this into my agreement that you cannot delay payment.
See, it's like, you know, sometimes the bank sanctions a loan against a state government guarantee.
Mm.
Now, it's very difficult to invoke that guarantee.
Mm. Mr. Bansal, you know...
It sounds very well.
Yeah, but it doesn't work that way.
Well, Mr. Bansal, in hindsight, you know, now it's been 1 year of the circular. What are the few changes that you'd like to see for, you know, a better functioning, better implementation of the circular? Of course, leaving aside the one-day default rule.
One-day default is only for saying that somebody has to go to resolution. But coming to your point, at least I would like to have two changes. One, as Mr. Swers was saying, and the Companies Act provides 75%, IBC itself provides 66%, the earlier JLF provided 60%.
Okay.
So I think the percentage of approval for this 100% needs to be changed. I can understand RBI's point that what they want is that all the banks should find a resolution.
Mm-hmm.
I think I remember in one case recently banks were trying to find a resolution, but two banks were not agreeing. So those two banks' exposure, the larger bank bought it just to ensure that 100% consent is there.
Okay.
And this Sashakt will not work because in Sashakt RBI doesn't recognize. So even if Sashakt is signed, those banks do agree. But even then, you don't reach 100%, then what happens?
Yeah.
So finally, I think one issue is that 100% needs to be changed. Mm. Maybe RBI's view is that the banks also should find a resolution.
Okay.
So they should go for maybe OTS, they should go for sale to ARC or whatever. The idea is that this case should get resolved.
Mm.
I mean, fine, that's a fine point. The second thing I feel that should be changed is when you do a restructuring, you should slightly relax investment grade rating, because if you are asking investment grade rating, it is a very lesser amount.
Mm.
And banks are not keen to do restructuring also and accept that lesser amount. then banks will say, okay, fine, I will accept that lesser amount through NCLT or through sale itself, no? I think that is another area perhaps needs to be changed along with the 20% clause. I would say this 20% payment is again difficult by such clients.
Okay. Okay, so those would be the changes you would want. Sunil, any changes you would want?
I would like, you know, it's a wish list, an ideal situation.
Okay.
But if the government were to begin imposing trades across, especially for the larger companies as also for itself.
Yes.
I think half the problems would be solved.
Okay, that's absolutely a wonderful suggestion. Mr. Sharma?
Yes. See, so far the restructuring is concerned, there is a need to relook, because if account is not restructured, everybody is losing. Maybe another borrower is getting this asset in a higher price. Then you relook at that. Of course, the RBI tied a CDR, then 5/25. Some other things could not work out. But that should not be a reason not to try again. After all, it is in the interest of the nation that the projects come up. And especially in accounts where the default is on account of factors external to the borrower.
Okay.
There is a difference.
Can you explain?
Those
go
accounts,
ahead.
There need to be a regulatory forbearance. I see, like you look at power sector. Now, coal linkage and land acquisition, due to various reasons, including governance issues, many of the projects could not come up.
Okay.
So, there if you apply the same guidelines, whereas there are accounts where there has been diversion of fund, the loan was, the fund was not used for the purpose
I get your point. You're saying
there,
that.
There I would, I would like to make one important point here.
Yes.
The insolvency code treats them at par. That means a person whose business failed for factors external to him.
Yes.
Is face the same consequences as a defaulter, willful defaulter. There is no live ban for these borrowers. That is where there is a need to change the insolvency code. The people who have indulged in fraudulent activities.
No,
they should be banned for life.
Mr. Sharma, you know, you and Sunil are actually talking about the same point. Sunil is saying change the ecosystem. So now, last word from you, Suharsh. You know, the Reserve Bank can't change the world, but at least it gave an ultimatum and told the government that, you know, your DISCOM is not paying. It just brought the truth out. So do you think the RBI should back down and say, okay, land acquisition was not on time and therefore forbearance, or should it stick to its stand? And it is the state agencies who have to change their behavior.
No, that's a very fair point. If I can just take you back to why, you know, RBI had the various other schemes, the STR, CDR, 525, and that will lead me to the answer. So Dr. Raghuram Rajan, in his book, when he was talking about his days in the RBI, he says that the reason RBI came up with all these schemes is because India did not have any restructuring law. So RBI basically became the proxy restructuring lawyer of the country. But RBI is a banking sector regulator, and it has to look out for its constituency.
Yes.
And we live in an ecosystem in which the power sector woes are because of the DISCOMs not being able to pay, the Supreme Court cancelling the coal licenses, and there are various other issues in the government sector as well. The point is, in Feb 12 circular, in the Supreme Court, along with the Power Producers Association, you also have the Finance Ministry and the Union of India supporting the contention of the power producers, saying that, you know, Feb 12 should be relaxed to a certain extent. But the point remains that all the dues are coming from the government sector.
Exactly.
So if the government is supporting the power producers in their quest in the Supreme Court, at the same time, it's upon them to make sure that the state and the central bodies which are leading to delays in the payment resolve it. Because at the end of the day, RBI does not have a panacea to all the issues plaguing the banking sector. There are other government entities which should be looking out for them.
Absolutely. Well, we have to wind up this discussion. Mr. Bansal, Sunil Srivastava, Mr. Sharma and Suharsh, thank you very much for joining us. Key takeaways, the circular can perhaps make 66% of banker agreement mandatory and thereby give some relief. Maybe it can also not require 20% repayment of principal for a restructuring package to be approved. So some tweaking can be done. But the main challenge that the February 12 circular throws on the system is that government and other entities should keep their side of the bargain. As Sunil says, the answer lies in making the trades exchange mandatory for all public sector entities and all government entities so that payments come on time. Ultimately, it's a question of RBI telling the government to keep its side of the bargain. Well, the government itself is opposing that circular in the Supreme Court and asking for relaxations. That gives you an idea of how things are shaping up. Thank you very much for watching this special edition of Indianomics.